All right, so very good afternoon to all of you, our cherished viewers of Hot Issues, and welcome to another exciting and interesting edition of Hot Issues. So, the ban, on illegal small-scale mining, of course, after the three-week ultimatum, is in force now, and so we've all been talking about it, and there are many of you who say, well, why do you even have to ban something that is illegal? Well, the minister gave them an ultimatum. The ultimatum has expired, and now the conversation is on the way forward. This afternoon, we're looking at the way forward. How do we deal with this menace going forward? Yes, we have a ban. Yes, we have an ultimatum. But how do we sustain it? That is a discussion we're having after this short break. My name is Winston Amoa, and this is Hot Issues. When we return, I'll be introducing my guest, and then we'll begin deliberations on the way forward in dealing with the Galamsey menace. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues, and my guest for this afternoon is a former CEO of the Ghana Chamber of Mines. Of course, we all do know her, Dr. Joyce Aryee. Good afternoon.
And very pleased to meet you. Yes,
pleased to meet you also. Yes. I believe you're doing very well.
Yes, God is good to me, so I'm doing very well.
Indeed, God is very good to you. I can see that. knowing the things I know, I can say that God has been good to you.
Oh, my goodness. You may know things that I don't know.
No. The things you also know.
Okay.
Anyway, so let's get into, an area you're very familiar with.
Okay.
Over the last month or so, we've been engaged in this fight. What's your assessment of, this whole effort against dealing with Galamsey once and for all?
Yes. What I'd like to say is that this is the first time we've had such a concerted nationwide effort. And it's been quite interesting, listening to, watching people, hot debates on the pros and cons. And it looks like we've got the whole nation interested in the menace. And for me, that's a positive. To even have the media go on a nationwide campaign. Last Friday, I wore red,
Okay, yes. The Red Friday.
The Red Friday. Because the issues are so important. So I think that it is a plus. This is the first time we've looked at the problems in their entirety. For example, we had talked about the fact that water bodies were under threat. And it looks as if people didn't quite realize the enormity of the situation. I remember watching a video clip on the news in the Chebbi area where Ghana Water says they have shut down their machines because the water body is just too murky. They would ruin the machines. So where do they get water? So we really are in a serious situation, and it's all the big waters. Ankobra, Pra, Ofin, Brim, you can't live like that. Mm. You can't live like that. So we really need to stop, look at the issues again, and re-strategize and make sure that we resolve the problems.
What issues should we be looking at?
We have always talked about the fact that mining is an income-generating activity. Mm. But that it should be done in a regulated fashion. You have large-scale mining, you have small-scale mining, you have artisanal mining. They all come under regulations. So you can't have a situation where some people decide that they will breach the law, break every available law, because they want to earn a living. I don't think it is good. And in so doing, actually create problems way beyond what they are benefiting from and affect the whole nation. I think we need to bring a stop to that. And I'm glad that the minister is saying that they have this MMIP,
yeah.
I think multi-sectoral mining improvement program
yeah.
something like that, so that they're going to address issues from all angles or as many angles as possible. Yeah. I know a lot of people are very cynical. But for once, let's see, how we can all of us, I don't think we'd like to have a situation where we are importing water.
Yes, but would you blame them based on what's happened in the past?
Well, you see, I believe in the past helping the present and the future. So, yes, some terrible things happened in the past, but you can look at those terrible things and see how the present can be better and the future even better still.
Because they make reference to 2013, for instance.
Yes.
I mean, there was all this tax force on illegal mining.
Yes.
What happened? We're back to it again.
Yes. We've had other campaigns as well.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, but it doesn't mean you should stop. It doesn't mean you should stop. Because if you did it and it didn't work, you have to find out, re-strategize, and do it again. I know some people who have had to write exams. They fail, they write again, they fail, they write again. Can you imagine if they decided to stop because they failed? Mm. They wouldn't be the big people they are today. So I think that the fact that we did something and it didn't quite work should not stop us from looking at it from the perspective of what caused things not to work the way we wanted, and what can we do to make sure that this time we'll achieve as much positive results as possible.
If there's one lesson we can learn from the previous campaigns, what would that be?
What it will be is to get Minerals Commission to take the whole issue of licensing, monitoring very seriously. You know, for example, I heard that somebody had been in a very galamsey-prone area for 10 years. You don't keep a person like that for 10 years because obviously the person is incapable of monitoring and making sure that you get the good, right results.
Okay.
You know, that's one of the things, for example. And a constant check, because you know it's a threat, it's a menace. It's not that somebody just finds a small plot of land and does something, it doesn't affect anybody. No, this time it's affecting the whole nation. So you want to ask yourself, if you are an institution that's been charged with ensuring that the right things get done, then you should make sure that you should also look at the way forward. For example, I know that by the laws, I don't know whether by the latest review of the mining law, artisanal and small-scale mining can now use certain types of equipment that they're using now.
Mm.
Because even the equipment they're using now really are not supposed to be used, you know. So knowing that maybe the land that you allot to them require the use of heavy equipment, how would you regulate the small-scale mining? Is this small scale because of the land size? Is this small scale because of the equipment? Is this small scale because of the number of people?
Mm.
You need to look at all those things. You know, we're training a lot of mining engineers, you know, mineral engineers, we're geologists and so on. How do you get the small scale sector to start employing such people so that they can do things better? We're training environmental protection people.
Sure.
You know, how do you get them to be a part not only of the agency but actually helping the companies to do things in an environmentally positive way?
From your experience, how difficult is it regulating this industry or sector?
I wouldn't say it is so difficult. I think there has to be a constant campaign to get people to understand what the right things are.
Mm.
It's like driving. You know, people still are driving without licenses, but
yeah,
you can't stop licensing people. Now, one of the things that happens in the communities is that sometimes landowners will say, "Asasinomia media," you know.
Mm.
But the law says that yes, the asase is yours, but whatever is under, which is a mineral, is not yours. It's held in trust for the whole of the nation. So really, no landowner ought to allow people to come to their land to do that. We have district assemblies.
Mm-hmm.
We have, you know, law enforcement personnel in all these areas. Now, how do we get the institutions that are regulating things to work with these law enforcement organizations for them to understand the issues? It's not Nayebedi Dien. Because if it is just Nayebedi Dien, then everybody will do what they like. But you know, we can't.
Yeah, but that's an issue that keeps coming up. The minister's just gone around. I mean, he's gone around. And even getting to the Western region, mm-hmm, he was told,
mm-hmm,
What do we do now?
But the
that
issue,
is a major
the,
issue.
The interesting thing mm-hmm. is that those people we see in the pits, all muddied up and so on, are laborers.
Yes.
It is those who have the money to own the equipment and to put the money in it who we should be addressing, because it is they who are edging these people on, the middlemen, the owners mm-hmm. of the equipment. The other day I heard somebody on news boasting that he has equipment that he hires out to do what is wrong. So we should be addressing these two, because now we have evidence that some people, it is not those who are in the trenches who are really the issue. Those in the trenches is like by day, you know, on a construction site. You'll have people carrying the mortar, doing this and doing that. Those are just the hirelings.
Yes, but Doctor, these people get their daily bread by engaging
what
in these activities.
What were they doing before they got that?
Well,
yeah.
Some of them, that's the first job they had. And so for them, it's their source of livelihood. And I've heard people already arguing that, look, what are we going to do?
A lot of them don't even belong to the areas. Do you know that?
Tell me.
Do you know that a lot of times people are even from outside Ghana involved in these outside Ghana?
They're not supposed to be working here in
exactly,
the first place.
Exactly, exactly. And it is not only those who seem so foreign that you can identify them. There are others like you and like me, you know, but who don't come from Ghana or who don't even come from the areas and so on. So the thing is that you find that the high amounts that they are paid attract so many people.
Good.
You know, attract so many people. You wouldn't even believe that some families don't even let their children go to school. Because if I, the mother or the father, can get 10 people working in the pits with me, and I get even 100 CDs per day, that's already something else.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that it also has a lot of social issues that we must address. A lot of social issues that we must address. And you can't always say that I'm waiting to have a perfect situation before I start dealing with the issues. That is why the multi-pronged, multi-sectoral approach should be given time and boost and help to move forward.
So do I get the impression that it's important to solve the livelihood issues?
Yes, of course.
If you do not,
yes,
you're likely to fail.
Yes. You're likely to have issues. It's not a question of failure.
We can't fail
because
in this.
No, because if, for example, you are able to streamline things and the small scale miners are working according to regulation and so on, they will employ people. Because the thing is, it's not a ban on mining. Remember, the minister has said so several times. You know, so the issue is, are we doing it in a regulated, legal way? So it's not a question of you're stopping that entirely.
But talking about the small scale mining.
So people will still have jobs if that is what they prefer to do.
People will still have jobs if that's what they
prefer,
of course.
Yes, but it will be in a regulated
in small scale mining.
Yes.
I mean, which
would and artisanal.
Artisanal. It took a long time to get licenses,
yes,
though. But
yes.
And that's also another issue.
It doesn't take a long time to get license.
It's taking people a year, two, three.
No. Again, when you go to Minerals Commission, you know Ghanaians, they don't like even going straight to where the issue is. I've had many times when people come to me and they say they want a passport and they want to come and see me. And I said, I don't give passports. Why don't you go to the post office and get yourself a form to start with? You know, we always want to use other people. Take the Goro boys as DVLA. Mm-hmm. Why can't you go there and get yourself a license? You know, so I think that a lot of times we have the perception that things are so bureaucratic and so difficult that you have to go through a middle person.
But that's the situation on the ground.
People start
the process. It takes them a long time and over the course. I mean, I have heard, he took over from you, now CEO of Minerals Commission,
yes.
Tony Obin, admitting that sometimes it takes a long time.
Yes.
And so some of these people are in there. Well, you might argue it's not the right thing to do, but because it takes a long time, they find themselves doing it illegally.
No, but you shouldn't break the law because it's a long time. So you want to get a license for your car, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you go to DVLA, it's taking you a long time, so you still put the car on the road to drive it, would you?
I wouldn't do
exactly.
that.
Exactly. And the person
somebody
who does
might.
It, but somebody who does it should be arrested. And if arrested, he can't claim that, well, I went there and it's taking me a long time, so I'm breaking the law. No. It shouldn't be like that.
But the
that.
Fear of breaking the law in that respect or regard is the reason why you say you have a timeline. So make it say 1 month, a month,
I agree.
2 months.
I agree.
Then you
and
move
that
on.
Is why you hold that institution accountable but for not even going by its own regulations. If, for example, that institution says when you apply, this is the time you will get it, and they breach it, they too should be held accountable by for breaching their own laws. You know, so it's not a question of the one on the ground, but the one who also should make it easy for the one on the ground not to break the law should be held accountable.
You talk about the ban on mining. I mean, of course, we are told this is not a ban on mining.
Yeah, I think it's time bound.
But there are some who are beginning to argue, ban mining totally.
Well.
And that's the end of it. We wouldn't have all these issues.
Yeah, it's like saying,
I mean, I've heard Oshihini say so.
I know people would like to see it that way. Ban all mining. But you see, mining is so critical to our lives. Even here in the studio, the chairs we are sitting on, all the metal is from mining. The television cameras, everything. There's so much that you get out of mining that you can't ban it and expect to live. So the issue is, what do you do to make sure that you do it well?
Shouldn't you be looking at, you know, we look at the pros and cons. We look at it. Say, okay, so let's look at what we get from mining.
Definitely.
And let's look at how mining is affecting us.
We
and then
should
begin
be doing
to make,
that. We should be doing that all the time.
So based on the situation on the ground, would you say mining has helped us so much that we continue?
Why are you qualifying by so much?
Has mining helped us so we continue?
I think so. I think mining has helped us a great deal. You know, there are a lot of communities where even though you haven't got the optimum results, you can say that if it hadn't been for the mining, even the townships would not be there. Yes.
Really? There have been here? I mean,
you know, I mean, go to Takwa. Why would there have been a university if there was no mining? I haven't thought of it that way. But now there's a viable university. The university itself is also an income-generating item. You know, you find that the town will even get bigger, you know, because the university is there, other economies are going to go there. One of the issues that I would like us to address as a nation, you know, from the perspective of what you're talking, we should ask ourselves very critical questions.
Sure.
What do we want mining to do for us? What do we want mining to do for us? If we gave somebody a mining license, what is the expectation in terms of what the community is going to derive, what economies are going to come there, what will come to the state as a whole, and so on. That should inform the way we give out licenses, whether it is large scale, whether it is medium scale, whether it's artisanal, whether it is small. We need to be asking ourselves very, very hard questions. And what minerals do we want to, you know, spend our time mining? Because that too is important. You want a value chain, you know, approach to every economic activity that you undertake. You know, I saw something online today which I thought was very interesting. Somebody who's got an app that shows us where you can get the best wache or where you can get.
Okay.
Yes. 22 people already on the app and more to come. You know, so if you want wache and you live in Dansoman, you go to the app and you probably find, you know, somebody selling wache somewhere, which is also very good. But you know, wache is also a value chain. Somebody has to grow the rice. Somebody has to grow the beans. Somebody will have to market it. There's some meat thing, tomatoes, this. So it's a whole value chain. And we should ask ourselves, what value chains that bring, you know, multiple economic advantages do we want from mining? That question has not been fully addressed, and we should address it as a nation. Now that we have this MMIP,
okay,
it should address it.
When we return from the break, we'll find out more about, you know, whether we have to ban mining totally and also deal with issues concerning small-scale mining. Now, those of you who are talking about the legality of small-scale mining, stay with us. This is Hot Issues, and our guest is Dr. Joyce Aryee. We'll be right back after the break. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues with me, Winston Amwa, and our guest this afternoon is Dr. Joyce Aryee, former CEO of the Ghana Chamber of Mines. So let's finalize it on this, you know, a ban on mining too. Now, the small-scale mining, I mean...
Small-scale gold and diamond, you know. Because we have other minerals.
Sure.
So you know, so I think that we must look at the other minerals that we have. Do you realize, for example, that clay is a mineral?
Sure.
And it's all over the country. Mm. And the value chain is enormous.
Sure.
You know, and so if it's jobs people are looking for, there's clay throughout the country. So are we going to encourage that? There are also other things like kaolin. There are other things like dolomite and so on. You know, I mean, what are we going to do to introduce the kind of minerals that also have value chains that can go directly into industry?
Okay.
I think we should be doing that.
We should be doing
that
also.
We shouldn't be that. So that it's not only an issue of gold.
Gold. Well, so talking about small-scale mining now. Mm-hmm. Now, there are those who have started arguing, because it's a provision of the Constitution that says that all mineral resources vested in the state, and they should be ratified by Parliament before you go into it. Small-scale mining licenses in Ghana are not ratified
by Parliament. Yes, but then that is also the duty of the Minerals Commission to make sure that the Ministry of Lands and Natural Resources responsible for mining sends the memo to Parliament with the list of those who have been given licenses, licenses which EPA has also dealt with in terms of the environmental impact and so on and so forth, and cleared them, you know, because it is not the fault of the license holders. If you tell them you're giving them a license to mine, it is your duty as an institution to take the issue to Parliament to do that. And if we are, in fact, there was a time when even large-scale miners were in that same predicament.
Yes.
We're in that same predicament because for years, you know, the ministry had not sent the issues to Parliament for ratification.
So what do you suggest happens to these people, at these institutions?
Yeah, the thing is that I think that we need to monitor them more closely.
They're illegal.
And really, no, what I'm saying is that if you tell me that you've given me a license, and by the laws, not only of the Constitution, but by the laws that you are operating as an institution, it says that if I haven't heard from you from within a certain length of time, I would deem it as you have approved of what I'm supposed to do, you know, and I don't hear from you and I start doing, then you have to move very fast to make sure that I'm doing the right thing. Mm. So I think that, you know, we should make sure that our institutions do the right thing. It's very important.
Well, the supreme law of the land, the Constitution says.
Fine.
So once the Constitution says so, what is illegal is illegal. Stop
no,
it.
But then the institution that is supposed to, if you say so, but then cause that institution, hold the institution accountable for even causing financial loss to the state. You see, because
so in this case, the Minerals Commission.
Yes. Why not? Why not? You know, if the Minerals Commission is the minister's technical arm that ensures that the right thing should be done and it is not doing it, then you need to ask questions. What is making it impossible or difficult for them to do what they have to do? Have they gone to Parliament and been refused by Parliament to do it? If so, what can the minister do to make sure that Parliament also works within a certain frame of time? I think that's how you get institutions to work.
Okay, so let's look at, you know, the reclamation process now. Yes, I mean...
For me, that is very,
very
important.
Very important. How do we start?
You know, when you go to EPA, EPA has really worked very hard on processes for reclamation and so on. It's not only EPA, Water Resources, Forestry Commission, you know, all these. Forestry Commission will give you the right plants, you know. For example, when you are restoring a mined out land and you put out, I'll talk from the perspective of the large scale mining.
Okay.
When you take the topsoil, you don't destroy the topsoil, you put it aside. Because later on, you'll have to put back the topsoil. And then you have to introduce what they call nitrogen fixing plants, like beans and creepers and so on, so that you enrich the soil before you start planting. And certain trees are also nitrogen fixing. You make sure you do all that. So the processes for doing these are there. In fact, even Minerals Commission itself has some expertise, because I remember them having to reclaim some degraded lands that had been, you know, had been degraded because of past small scale, either legal or illegal activities and so on. Because when you charge them certain monies, you know, you have to make sure that some of these monies are used to reclaim. Now, the processes, the technology, and everything is there. Water resources, talking about the fact that you can restore even the water, but you have to start immediately. So we have the technology to reclaim, to restore, to rehabilitate. That is why really trying to bring some sanity into all the illegality is important. Mm-hmm. Because you need to reclaim your lands, you need to restore your water bodies to as near a pristine state as possible. And we need to start somewhere. I think it's very important.
Who bears the cost?
That is a very, very important question. I think part of the cost will be borne by Minerals Commission, because I'm sure that for those who are legal, they charge certain amounts and so on. I think that the illegals and those who have been identified, you know, should be fined to pay for the land that they have degraded. And I think that a lot of effort. I think we need to also consult the large-scale mining companies. You know, they may offer services that would otherwise cost money, maybe knowledge, seedlings, and technology, staff, and so on, you know, to help in this, because it has to be a national effort.
But the illegal miners, I mean, you want them fined and that be used in doing so. But to me, they do not have the money. You hardly get there, you know, like you stated.
Oh, no. The thing is that those who are in the trenches
you
are
don't
not
get
the,
them. Yes.
No, they are not the illegal
exactly.
miners. But then you remember that the minister said he has recovered over 500 and something
excavators,
yes, but with owners.
Because some have been moved to the middle of the communities and they are left there.
No, but the thing is that you can track. Because when you bring an excavator, you have to go through some processes before you bring it to use.
Some don't.
I think you can track many of them. Because I know that the Minerals Commission has started that process of working with SEPs and so on, you know, the ports, to track, you know, owners of these things. So, you know, if we make the effort, we'll be able to,
do unfortunately, that. The minister has asked these owners to show up and then move.
Some of them have even talked on radio.
Yeah, move the excavators.
Yes.
You know, and it's given them an additional 30 days.
Yes, I'm sure some will show up, because the thing is that those who perhaps genuinely want to be a part of small scale and artisanal mining, they would come, you see, because for them, it's not an issue of doing something illegal, but it is an issue of being part of mining. Let's remember that. Some people genuinely want to be part of mining and they will show up. I mean, when you have even foreigners saying that, look, we came to help, to give technical advice. Mm. So it means they are also there. They said they brought technical advice or technical help.
By way of Shanfan?
Yes. You know,
and
so
that's the technical help. They,
that's what they claim, that they came, you know, so at least they are identifiable. So you may not identify everybody, but I think that you will identify some. And then the state will have to find some resources to do that. Yes.
Why not, like you say, I mean, find the people and they would have to pay
for
everything.
No, you know, but it's not going to be enough, because this is a long-term thing. So I think we'll have to have a concerted effort to do that.
Should we use the seized excavators to do the reclamation in some instances?
Oh, you'll have to, because if you have to bring in some topsoil, you need these excavators to do that.
And that's not supposed to come at any cost to the state.
That's why it would be useful to find those who brought it illegally.
In any case,
if some of them brought it illegally, then they would have paid some monies and so on. You know, sometimes the landowners also, they are identifiable. Mm. Can identify the landowners. You know, for some people, until it hurts them, they won't stop doing what is wrong. But when it really hurts them, in their pockets, in their stomachs, and elsewhere, they will make sure that they do the right thing.
Well, the new act says when you, see people using these equipment, you seize them. And in fact, you confiscate them to the state, take them to court, confiscate them to the state, and then you could choose to sell them off. So I think we have a way of going about it.
Yeah, so if the law is there,
yeah,
then
the law is there, let's
apply the law.
It's obvious that you
let
can do
us
so.
Apply the law.
And that's how come I was surprised when the minister gave an additional 30 days and said that
they
you
need
move
to
them.
Find the identifier.
Seize it.
Yes.
Because since they've moved it to the
middle
of the communities. But those people who are engaged in it and are, you know, always crying, we don't have sources of livelihood. Would this be the best moment to give them something by way of getting them involved?
The thing is that the minister is saying we want to rationalize artisanal and small-scale mining, which is lawfully accepted. So part of the rationalization will take care of quite a number of people. Part of the rationalization. So it's not a question of if there are, let's say, 700,000 people, all of them are going to lose their jobs. So let's see how much part of the rationalization will handle the issues properly. You know, I know people who have licenses, genuinely, and they don't have funding. You know, those things will also have to be addressed. Because if we want Ghanaians to get into mining, and we know mining is capital intensive, how do we make sure that the Ghanaians we give the licenses to can access money to do the mining legally, profitably, environmentally friendly, and everything? These are things we need to
how
discuss.
How do we ensure that?
You have to ensure that you create the conditions for them to have known mineralization. For example, you give me land. And all you tell me is that an airborne geophysical study says that there's some presence of gold. If the land has not been properly explored to know the amount of mineralization in the place, I mean, it is a recipe for disaster because I'm going to have to do a lot of trial and error. So I'll just be digging and digging and digging and digging and digging. But when I know the known mineralization, I'll do a feasibility study. I'll present my feasibility study to the bank. That is what the large-scale mining companies do. You know, you present it, and if it is known that within the next 5 years, you have, let's say, 1 million ounces of gold, and it is verifiable, then it can be, you know, money can be
given
to you. You know, it's a loanable project. So we should be doing all this, you know, we should be supporting. So as part of Ghanaians in mining, we must also support the way we are doing with SME, entrepreneurship and so on. We should see this also as part of the entrepreneurship and see how we can help Ghanaians in mining. You maybe even providing the exploration facilities to them at a cost, of course.
So in that case, I mean, should the Minerals Commission or say government go ahead and, you know, assess all the land and say there's this amount of
gold. We have also a geological survey.
So
yes.
They do that and say, okay, so this is
exactly
it.
So this is how much maybe it costs you, you know, and then you can, if you know that they don't have the money upright up front, you can have a way in which you can guide them. You know, this is where PPP and stuff like that can come into it.
Well, because in Zimbabwe, that's how it's done.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, the government has done everything. So
yes.
When you go in there, you're giving a land.
Exactly.
And then that's,
yes.
You know,
so
the way that
if
it
can
works.
Be done in Zimbabwe, how come it can't be done in Ghana?
Well, but let's look at, you know, foreigners. Yes, we're talking about an illegality here, but there's also those who've asked that question. How do we, and you talked about foreigners being involved, how do we deal with foreigners who are involved in illegal mining?
Yes. And again, it is us, the Ghanaians, who invite them to come. What did you say? The equipment is called
Shanfan.
Yeah. You know. You know, people have a nose for smelling business. And so somebody hears that a certain country produces a certain equipment and sees opportunity and so visits the people and say, you know, I don't have money, but if you come to my country, I can get you to sell your this, that, that. It's the Ghanaians, we bring them here, you know. And so we need to talk to each other. Nobody is saying you shouldn't do good business, but why would you destroy your country in the process of making money for your pocket? You know, somebody will say this is a moral question. But then you're not an island. You know, what you do affects other people.
Sure.
So we should do that. And then we must also, this is where the monitoring. If, for example, you are a mining inspector in a community and you know that this kind of equipment is not supposed to be used for the mining activity, which may even be licensed, you have to raise the issue. You have to raise the issue and cause the institutions to begin, not only maybe Minerals Commission, but the law enforcement institutions to be involved in ensuring that the right things get done. But if you remember earlier on, I had mentioned that it is important to ask ourselves at this stage of mining, will we say that artisanal mining is supposed to be a shovel and pickaxe activity? Have we not gone beyond the shovel and pickaxe? Even you, if you want to mine clay, you can no longer get, you know, clay using shovel and pickaxe. So should we not be thinking of equipment? Now, if equipment is coming in, what are the environmental issues? Should we not be working with the Environmental Protection Agency to find ways in which, you know, CSIR, you know, water resource, and so on and so forth? So really, this multisectoral approach is very important, because that is how we can address this economic activity. But in addition to that, it is very important to avoid making mining the only economic activity in any area, because mining has a lifespan. And when the mining is over, you know, if you have not dealt with reclamation and restoration and so on, you will have a lot of, you know, degraded lands on your head and a lot of unemployment on your hands. So I think that as we discuss all these things, we should also begin thinking, what kind of agriculture, for example, can go coexist with mining?
Okay.
Maybe not in terms of land mass, but you know, there's this new kind of agriculture. It's not new in many countries. You know, the tent kind of, it has the name.
I've forgotten that name. Yes,
you've forgotten the name, but where you do a tent, you know, and you mine. It doesn't take so much space, but you can get a lot of harvest from it, you know. So if vegetable farming is something that can coexist in, you know, a mining area, we should exponentially increase that kind of thing and use it for export and other things. You know, so we should find alternatives. And part of the alternative should not be just, you know, very, very tiny scale with maybe just one acre of land or something like that. But we should really be exponentially thinking of these things. What other activities? Would welding be a good economic activity? Banking would be a good economic activity, you know. If you're doing clay, for example, you can see how the value chain can go. You'll have to send people who do pots, who glaze, who do that, you know, who produce things even for the large scale mining companies, because they use clay pots in getting their assays done and so on. So you can do a whole value chain and create a lot of economies around mining.
All right, so we'll go for our final break. When we return, we'll still be talking about issues of mining and other issues that we'll delve into right here on Hot Issues with me, Winston. Our guest is Dr. Joyce Aryee. Stay with us. We're right back after this break. All right, so welcome back from our final break, and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues on TV3 with me, Winston Amwa, and our guest this afternoon is Dr. Joyce Aryee, former CEO of the Ghana Chamber of Mines. So in the past, I mean, this is not the first time we've had a fight against illegal mining. In the past, we have failed. And the reason
we haven't quite succeeded.
Well, I like you know, the politically correct language, you know, but in the past we've failed or haven't quite succeeded in dealing with this challenge, because some politicians have been involved in it, some chiefs have been involved in it, and also even some security operatives. Going forward, how do we ensure
we find a security person involved in it, deal with the person drastically by law? When we find a politician involved in it, name and shame is very important, and use the law against such a person. If chiefs are doing it, the same thing. I'm glad that the Chief Justice has now set up 14 courts. We started discussing with her predecessor how to establish specific mining courts, and we were part, as the chamber, part of helping them understand some of the issues and so on and so forth. 14 courts, that's a great thing, and it means that whether you're a chief or not, if it is found and proven that you've done that, the law must take its course. You know, we must stop this issue of early morning arrival from people coming to say, oh, well, you know, it is only a human being who does wrong. And when your child defecates on your thigh, you don't cut the thigh. So we are always promoting wrongdoing. It gets to a stage where it has to stop because of the cost to the country. It is no longer a cost to a small community. Look at where the PRA, comes from.
Exactly.
You know, and how many places are touched by this river? Think of the Brim, think of the Ankobra, think of the Ofin, and so on. So many people are touched by this. You know, so I think that the chiefs, if the House of Chiefs finds that this is what you're doing and it is proven and you are sent to court and so on, then the law must take its place and you should be destooled. You know, that kind of thing. Because really, we must apply the law. One of the things we are not very good at is applying the law. Winston is my relative, and is a relative to that one, and is a relative to that one. So if you do that to Winston, you're going to affect me, and so on. And we create more and more problems for ourselves. I think we should also start from the beginning. You know, sometimes when you are doing these campaigns, we forget to include school children.
Okay.
We really should take, and I think that, I hope Ken Ashibe is listening to this, part of the media campaign should also link up with Ghana Education Service, and we should let our school children understand, you know, the menace of illegal mining, and let them understand the advantages of properly regulated mining, so that the children can talk to their parents, the children will understand some of these things and so on. And we raise a generation that understands that doing the right thing is eventually advantageous for everybody. That's one of the things we should do. And even involve the school children in part of the rehabilitation methods. If there's tree planting and so on, you know how exciting it is when children think that they are planting trees, and you even tell them that put your name there and make sure that this tree grows, because when it grows, it means you're also growing in life.
Sure.
You know, so we should be very creative about the ways we do the rehabilitation. I think it's important.
All right, so talking about school children, let me just take you into education.
Don't take me there.
No, an area you have expertise in. So,
do I really?
You do, and so you do. So, and that's one area that, if you look at Ghana's educational system, the quality of education in this country, does it make the Ghanaian child globally competitive?
Some, but not the majority.
Why?
I think that we still have some inequalities. Where was I? I went to a village, and on the way to Obuasi, just this weekend, and I saw a school building, and my heart broke.
Why?
I mean, really, that building should not even be used as a chicken coop. It's falling apart. The ceiling is very low. the children will not have light in the room and so on. And here is a school that will be competing with other schools, maybe even in that same Obuasi area, you know, where the school buildings are better, where the teachers are better resourced not only in terms of the money they take home, but with the right teaching materials and so on. And that inequity is there. You know, we have to really make sure that each Ghanaian child is seen as a Ghanaian child, and teaching and learning facilities, including teachers. You know, I really think that we need to rearrange teachers. We need to put a lot of value on teachers, because if the one who's giving the information is himself or herself not up to scratch, you know, then what you're giving is not good enough. So we really need to look at our teacher education and teacher, you know, involvement very seriously. And I know that, at least I've heard the minister talking about this, I've heard the president himself talking about value for teachers and so on. So until we clear the inequalities, you know, it's going to be very difficult. I mean, somebody is going to school in Accra, even if it's a public school in Accra, is getting better facilities than somebody in a village where they are still lying on the floor to write. And they are writing the same exams.
Talking about exams, I mean, there are those who have advocated that, you know, that we establish another examination body, you know, to compete with WAEC as a way of dealing with leakages.
You know, sometimes I think that we don't solve fundamental problems, but we try to massage and put plaster on sores that maybe ought to have surgery. So I think that what we need to do is to have a surgical operation on institutions that we think require these things, you know. And then the leakages, who causes the leakages? Teachers, parents, and so on and so forth, you know.
Because they say that's the only way you have to go through to secondary school.
One of the things that I think we should really critically look at, we are creating a nation of paper holders, but not educated people.
What's the difference?
The difference is that you have a certificate which says that you have been educated, but maybe you've been through school, but you haven't really been touched by school. Because an educated person is supposed to be a critical thinker. An educated person is supposed to be very creative, is a problem solver, and so on. Because an educated person is helped to know that the information they gain is practical information for daily life. You know, most people talk about fractions. Are they necessary at all? But of course, they are necessary. If you are sent to go and buy something and it is 1 CD 50 pesos, that's fraction, isn't it? Yes,
it is.
It's fraction. But the thing is that if the teacher does not make me understand that you sent me to buy something and it is 75 pesos and that it is a fraction of 1 CD, then I don't see the value of fractions.
Sure.
You see? But if I'm made to say that it is part of daily life, then I apply the knowledge immediately. So that is part of the teaching. Teaching has to be exciting. And that's why I'm very keen that we reorient our teachers. Let them also catch the excitement of passing on knowledge, not just information. Knowledge, applicable knowledge. I think that orientation is important.
Well, talking about issues of fractioning, I know there are many of you who've seen that video questioning, for instance, what the use of par r square is.
Yes.
You know, yeah. I mean, you've seen people, you know, questioning the use of pi
but all
r square.
But all these things are relevant for ordinary life. Maybe the way they were framed. You know, when we were going to school, we were made to feel that algebra and so on were not important. You see, but these are applied.
I get you. I mean, there were things I understood when I got to the university.
Yes.
I looked back and said,
yes.
So this is what you were being taught at the time.
Yes.
And that was 6 years after
that.
Anyway, finally, what do you make of the free SHS program? Does it solve the problem?
I think it will go a long way. It will go a long way. You see, because you need an educated crop of people to become your human capital. Education is about building human capital. And you know, your development depends on your human capital. We were talking about discriminations and inequalities and so on. If you can upscale equality, you would have done a good thing. Upscale the equality issue.
And finally, before we conclude.
Finally.
How well have we fared in our fight against corruption?
It is a fight that we must continue. In fact, every day the fight must get stronger, because it is not a fight that you are going to totally eradicate. But what is going to happen is that people are going to know the consequences, and they will be so drastic. You remember the Enron and such cases and so on. It has brought some sanity, but it has not completely eradicated. People are still being fired for doing the wrong things. So when you apply the law and people know that law, you don't get away with wrongdoing. It is a fight that you can win. It is like malaria. We are still fighting it, and we are nearing solution stages.
So we should continue.
And it's a rage. You know, there's no one time when the fight against corruption should be, the temperature should not be lowered.
Do you think we're committed to it, particularly
we
leadership?
We have to but commit ourselves. Well, the thing is that you have to take them at their word.
They say they're committed? But
part of leadership is you and me. Am I willing not to pay bribe to get what ought to come to me because it is what an institution should do for me?
Am I willing not to pay?
Yes, I'm willing also not to pay. I'm willing to wait.
Dr. Joyce Aryee, thank you very much.
Thank you, Winston. When is our next one?
I would consult my production team.
Thank you.
All right, so you want to say something finally?
No.
All right, so that's all from us this afternoon, Hot Issues. Thank you so much for joining us. Our guest has been Dr. Joyce Aryee. My name is Winston. I'm on behalf of the team. I say have a lovely weekend, and I'll see you on Monday on 3FM 92.7 from 5:55 a.m. to 10 a.m. Goodbye.